It's rather been a week of skyrocketing fuel prices, and those with the liters were able to make abnormal profit at the expense of those that did not have. But the question is, for how long will this go on, and what does it mean for the entire economy at large? Welcome to The Business Show. Here are weekly highlights of news in the business world. High fuel price blamed on delay to test truck drivers. Bank of Uganda crafts guidelines for SME green financing. Is Icelandic company turning carbon dioxide into stone? And US Airlines warn of calamity should 5G be installed near airport.
We, as a cooperative, we provide a predictable price. Mm. But as a cooperative, we cannot be able to pay every day.
Sometimes when you start a business, yes, profit is very important. But I think quality is the best.
Welcome to the show. Now, KFC, a chain restaurant, recently ran low on the supply of Irish potatoes used to make their famous potato chips, and that is at one of their outlets in Kenya. What was rather surprising is the fact that they could not outsource from the local farmers in Kenya. That has only happened not only in Kenya, but also in Uganda and several other areas. So the question is, what exactly is the problem, and why can't these people outsource from local farmers? Tonight, on Views from the Top, we speak to the president of Uganda Farmers Federation, Dr. Dick Kamuganga.
Good evening, viewers. My name is Dr. Dick Nwamanyaka Mganga. I'm the president of Uganda National Farmers Federation. And our main purpose, our main mandate is mobilize, organize, and empower smallholder farmers and speak for them, as well as partner for them. And then also look at the challenges and the opportunities associated with the farming sector. I'm pleased to be here to speak to you. Statistically, we actually have had a very positive agricultural growth as a sector, 3.8%. If you look the progressively in the last 2 years, that's above the population growth rate. And you know that the agriculture sector is the driver of growth in the country. If it goes behind the schedules, then we have challenges, especially in food security. We were negatively affected by COVID. Since March 2020, we have seen a slumber in the sector because of specifically of effects on our demand for our products, the farm products. You can just simply have a glimpse of what exactly happened. When schools got locked down, tourists are not coming into the country, and workshops were not being held, gatherings are not held, and ceremonies are not held. That is a loss of demand for our products, because whenever there is a gathering, whenever there is a school, there is consumption of farm products. So you had a cry from farmers all over the country, especially for those producing matoke. All the farm products had negative effects when it came to what we produced and the supply. The supply and demand was affected, but nonetheless, the sector grew at 3.8%. Absolutely, our target is above 7%, and you know very well that the official statistics indicate 70 67, 70, 80% of our citizens who are employed in the agriculture sector. Depending on which statistics you read, but to me, I have a strong conviction that we provide, the sector provides the largest proportion of employment in the country, above 85%. So what we have seen, the main challenge that has affected us basically is value addition. And then an opportunity emerged in a recent government program called National Development Plan 3. National Development Plan 3 prioritizes agro-industrialization. So as partners with government, we have embraced the National Development Plan 3, focus on agro-industrialization. So what we are doing is mobilizing, sensitizing, to ensure that the farmers focus on the opportunities that are coming from NDP3, agro-industrialization. We thank the government for actually supporting through NADS, these equipment being given to the farmers, farmer groups. We support government for looking at a capitalization of UDB, Uganda Development Bank, and giving support to cooperatives. UDB is focusing on agro-processing. With agro-processing, with agro-industrialization, the key outcome will be value-added products. And value-added products is simple. Quality goes up, and the shelf life goes up, and then the price also goes up. When you value-add, you've entered into the industrial products. Industrial products usually have stable prices. So we enter into, we get out of price volatility, which is characteristic of agriculture because of low level quality commodities. So what has been the role of the Federation in this? We mobilize, organize, sensitize and empower to grab these opportunities that the government is looking. We are actually strengthening our partnership with the Minister of Agriculture. The fact that the current minister is the former president of Uganda National Farmers Federation. So he understands the DNA. So we have strengthened our working relationship with him. We are working closely with OWC, Operation Wealth Creation and NADS, to ensure that these goals that have been put in NDP3 and the goal of agro-industrialization is accelerated among the farmers within the framework of parish development model. To a region. The export market is a very complex one. At least from my experience, I have seen there are several factors to look at. Number one is quality. Once you have quality assurance, then you search for the next for the market outside. But there is also politics. Competition is very critical. Competition, exports are good for the exporter, but exports are bad for the importer. So they have domestic markets. And domestic constituencies. For Kenya, we have seen it depends on us several times for grains. When it produces its own grain, then the imports from Uganda are bad. It locks the gates. But this is not, politics cannot only be the excuse that I'm going to give. I think it's incumbent on our country. It's incumbent on us to meet international standards as producers and become competitive. And as we speak right now, the new PSST, that is the permanent secretary and secretary to the treasury, has injected in a momentum on what he calls the industrial policy. Industrial policy has an inward looking but also an outward looking strategy. An inward looking looks at how do we improve our competitiveness as producers and as exporters. And that's why agro-industrialization is very key in there. Agro-industrialization will drive quality up, not down. And once there is confidence on our quality, we will penetrate the international markets, both in the region and outside the region, the global markets. Now, there are opportunities that have emerged because of the African Continental Free Trade Area. So we are visualizing our competence within our competitiveness within East Africa, within COMESA, and the African continent. And later on, take charge of the markets that are provided by European Union, everything but arms, then the Americans and the Chinese.
All right, let's talk a bit about smallholder farmers, because I know for a fact that we have the bigger players, but these small guys make a bigger number. How are you bringing them on board to ensure that they look at quality if they are to export?
We have embarked, again, with the support from the ministry and the support from OWC, we are embarked on mindset change. Farmers, unless consistently smallholder farmers, do not know that drying their maize, they know how to know that drying their maize on the floor affects the quality of the maize and therefore affects the opportunities for regional and international markets, including our own domestic markets. It doesn't mean aflatoxins should be consumed by locals. So this has been a knowledge gap to know that actually the practices at the farm affect the quality, affect the market, affect the price, affect the opportunities of a smallholder farm. So what we have been advocating and what we are going to be working with, because we have submitted our budget support request after identifying this challenge, we are going door to door, farmer to farmer sensitization on quality issues. We are, for instance, in grains, we are supporting the idea of micro warehouse receipt system, and whereby we are the managing agent of the warehouses at village level. And these would be farm stores owned by the farmers, but supervised by their organization, to ensure that whoever submits the output, the produce, it is of a certain quality in terms of moisture content, in terms of drying it, in terms of ETC, all these practices that are expected at the farm. So we will be giving you a receipt as a confirmation of what you have kept with us. Once this maize or grain has reached at our store, we control the quality at this collective store.
Okay.
And then we look for the off-taker. We can be the off-taker as an organization. We are still into the transformation stage. We off-take, but we also seek for off-takers. So we are doing this also under the virtue program. We call it e-granary. And we got support from the World Bank, East African Farmers Federation. So the e-granary works on a principle. We profile a farmer, we profile their gardens, we profile the quantity they are producing, we provide the tarpaulins to ensure that the produce, the grain, is not put on the floor and contaminated. And so we ensure that each stage of the value chain, the farmer is supported to ensure he produces the quality that will be off-taken without question.
Okay.
So there are numerous efforts we are doing, but because the farmers, we are 16 million smallholder farmers out of the 4.5 million, out of the 7.5 million households in farming, 4.5 million households are smallholder farmers. And those are the farmers we are looking at. And you can imagine 16 million farmers, farming households, with a small organization like ours. So our impact is growing slowly.
Okay, Doctor, we're going to take milk for an example here, and you talk about collection points. And I know for a fact that There is now a tendency of some farmers choosing to go past collection centers because they feel cheated. How do we balance helping the farmer get value for their money, for the product they are supplying, but also ensuring quality by bringing the product to a collection center?
It's not actually only that for these farmers feel cheated. We need to understand the socio-economic dimension, circumstances of these farmers. As we return to school right now, I'm a dairy farmer and I belong to a cooperative, Avesugana. I belong to a cooperative back home. Supply of milk, we as a cooperative, we provide a predictable price. Mm. But as a cooperative, we cannot be able to pay every day. But a farmer has needs that may need on a daily basis. Some farmers have difficulties to meet their household needs, school fees, medicine, and the like. So they are competitors to cooperatives. We are in a liberal economy, open economy, where anybody can enter, anybody can exit in a sector and do that business. So some of these farmers, some of these businessmen bring the milk, like Sebiang is well known in Nkore. He brings the milk here, earns the money on a daily basis, goes and pays on a daily basis to the farmers who are supplying to him. So if the farmer needs money at that point, it is very difficult for that farmer to wait for 15 days when a cooperative is going to do what? So we need to, we have been advocating for redesigning. We are one of those who are proposing for the dairy development fund. A dairy development fund will look at the characteristics of farmers who are supplying milk, because the only way predictable to encourage quality is collective centers,
yes,
and or collective bargaining, collective value improvement. If we need to organize ourselves in that, collectiveness means we are self-organizing.
Right.
We are well-organizing and we can be supported well. But understanding those characteristics of some households and we get support to deal with them, we will be moving to a direction in which there is predictable quality, predictable price, and predictable quantities, as well as the capacity to export in different markets.
It's true what they say that in Uganda you cannot lack what to do as a business and also earn a living, and we shall find out after this break, but you're still watching The Business Show.